Hello. Well, there's one idea which underpins this presentation, and that is that the reception or the perception of imagery is backward compatible. And for that reason, before I tell you what I'm doing now, I'd like to remind you of some of the very important visual conventions which have been established over the centuries, which we just take for granted when we read imagery. Because imagery is quite different from the real world, from reading the real world. And there are a lot of very well-established ways of reading imagery that we use all the time. And so I'd like to mention them so that you can understand why certain things in holograms can't be read and can't be understood, and certain things can. And this is the only slide about this to start off with. This is at the top, or all over, the set, the physical object, ready for making an analog hologram that I made back in 89. There's a test plate of this, the hologram of this bar room in the MIT collection. So up the top, we see all the optics sitting up there. The holographic plate is going to be mounted instead of the mirror behind the bar. Big plate, 1.5 meters wide, 95 high. And it's going to record that image of that room there with a resolution that's actually higher than any other kind of image type that I know of. And in fact, it carries more information acuity-wise than we're actually capable of resolving. And for that reason, an analog hologram, the frame of reference, because I'm going to talk about frames of reference the whole time, the frame of reference, for the reason of resolution alone, often means that in reading the image of a hologram, we elicit a response to the real world. So here's the real world, and the hologram was going to be mounted as a mirror and read within this very highly structured context of a physical bar. But now let's go back to what I really mean by backward compatible. This image is a fresco. On the left will be the fine art historical work, and on the other side is a computer graphic model that I had made, which shows where the light is with respect to the figure in this composition. These case studies are taken from a book by the brilliant art historian Michael Baxendall, who wrote a book called Shadows and Enlightenment. And I would highly recommend that book to you because it describes how the representations of shadows in the Western world had revealed thinking and psychological perception. And he chose a case study by Giotto, by Masaccio, and by Leonardo as indicating three major shifts in thinking and representation. Now, we can see in this Giotto that the light is actually coming front on to the figure. So we're actually seeing a side view. See the lights in the computer graphic model? There's a little figure there, and we see the light shining onto her. The viewer is actually standing where that light is. Now, in religious work, what that does is it actually constructs the viewer as a light source, which is a very interesting idea. But this kind of use of the representation of light is just known simply as modelling tone. And it's used to represent a three-dimensional object on this basis, that the greater that the tilt of the three-dimensional object is away from the source, the darker it becomes. That's modelling tone is something which is used in every kind of representation. Okay, here's the next case study. This is Masaccio. And Masaccio's lighting, which is the light coming from top left and shining slightly over the shadow diagonally, is probably the most common type of representation of light in the world. And in fact, when you first got a computer and you pulled down the computer menu, there was a shadow underneath that pull-down menu. And where do you think the light source, the imaginary light source on that pull-down menu came from? It came from the top left, and the reason why is Masaccio set that visual pictorial code in stone, and that's why he's so revered. And here on, we've shifted things around a little bit. And just next to me is a drawing by Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci, and although I didn't really give full credit for what those artists did, I'm only just really choosing one, the dominant quality, okay? I'm not talking about all of the incredible intricacies. But Leonardo da Vinci, sort of changed his mind every day of the week, but he was one of the first people who actually thought of darkness as something that emanated from a source and actually kind of shone on people, if you can imagine shining darkness onto something, and that darkness actually became less as it went on, like the inverse square law for light, so that you got less and less dark as it went out. And he was really the genius of concealing microstructures within drawings by having one overall lighting pattern, which was fairly similar to Giotto, and within that nesting a whole lot of different sorts of lights, which were contrary to the overall lighting pattern. And so these three pictures I showed you were the subject of my first research project with holography, which was funded by the Australian Research Council of Australia, which funds university people to do research. And the outcome was this hologram over here on the left, which was produced at Zebra Imaging very beautifully by the same technique as the Bob Marley over there, and it has a fairly similar quality. It's a three-channel reflection hologram. You can see it here. This is a photo of it in the gallery. And what I did was see if I could transpose three-dimensionally these three different types of darkness and have them exist in three-dimensional space in a hologram. So as you walk from side to side in the hologram, you could actually see the differences in darkness made by Giotto, Masaccio, and Leonardo da Vinci. Now, this is the Giotto channel just next to me. This is, again, the hologram. And this is just reminding you of the Giotto lighting, but remember that you're supposed to be where the light is. Now, what we were able to do with this hologram, all the imagery was made in Maya by a computer graphic expert artist. I have no talent in that area. And what we were able to do was, in fact, change the light in every single pixel, so that when the viewer looked at this image of the person, wherever their eyes were, the light emanated from their eyes, so that although the figure was fixed, the lighting was mobile. And we've seen quite a few things about that today. So obviously when we make an analog hologram, in some way the light and the object are connected, they're bound together, but when we start to make digital things, we can separate those things and have them look quite different. Here's another completely different kind of light. I usually use this figure as my kind of test subject, so you see it come up a lot. But I don't know if anyone knows the artist that always does painting like this. There's Germans here. David Caspar Friedrich's paintings, like Wanderer Over the Mist, where you can't see the person, there's a light behind them. This is the opposite position of light from Giotto, and it's usually a very low light, but it has a particular meaning. It's linked with romanticism, and I think when we see it, we all understand it. But of course, our very own field, in fact, has its own predetermined lighting, which was not invented by an artist, was not established by anybody in the holographic community at all. In fact, it was established by special effects people who made Princess Leia. And if you look at this slide quite carefully, you'll realise that the light source and the direction is, in fact, how most holograms are portrayed in films. But the light, rather than just falling on the object, the light itself is also visible. So the second research project I did was concerning light and the representation of light in a media which is made from light itself. So, and of course, we will all realise that there's a huge difference between a computer graphic representation and the hologram itself. So I hope someone in the audience can help me play this. Help. Oh, I don't have a... Oh, hang on. It was just going to start then. What should I do? Go. No.
Oh, okay, there you go.
So this is just some footage of the hologram itself, and you can see there's a representation of a piece of light coming down onto the figure. And the only thing that was animated in this work was the light. So over the 8 seconds, the figures remained the same, but the light changed so that it began as a light figure on a dark background and ended as a dark figure on a light background. And in this work, I was using the language of cinematography and filmic framing, which in fact uses the third-third formula. And the other thing which was quite different is that I was using a kind of forced perspective, which simulated more the lensing look, because obviously software like Maya is designed to actually go into the film pipeline, but we're not able to use those lensing effects because our lens has to replicate the eye of the viewer, meaning that a lot of digital work often actually replicated reality, which really wasn't all that exciting. So we'll see how I can make this one work. I don't know. No, please. It's not working. Anyhow, I'll just explain by looking at this. This is actually a pre-visualization of the hologram that's been in the exhibition here at MIT. And I could show you if I could make it animate that. There's three different kinds of lighting here. There's actually four. So we have a reflection map, which, I have so many people to thank and so many, you know, amazing things to say, but I first saw a reflection map in Mike Halley's hubcap hologram, and I think that the reflection map is actually a really important part of computer graphics and the visual language of holograms, because it implies a space beyond the viewer space that is, you know, really 2D, but represents a three-dimensional space beyond. And so this hologram, which was made at Holographics North by John Perry, who's here today, shows down at the bottom, the light is through the glasses and seems to be coming towards the viewer. The light in the top glasses seems to be coming from the person who's looking at the hologram. The light on the glasses frame is the same as Giotto, and the background has no light on it at all. And it's very similar to having a laser image projected into your eye, which I had the great privilege of having Elizabeth project a beautiful image, which I will always remember my whole life. It said Nest, and it seemed as though it was inside my body. It was just an extraordinary experience. Anyhow, after spending 6 torturous years using Maya, I decided that really something had to be done. It was it took us so long to actually undo the image, because the transparent image, we realized that actually, because of Hollywood's way of representing holograms, that when a hologram's... Is it the end? Oh, no. Okay. Oh, it's too late. No, it's okay. Because Hollywood sort of taught people that holograms are transparent, what we really found out was that the more transparent a person is, the more real they seem in a hologram. And this is something which only happens in a hologram. It doesn't happen in other media. So we really need a lot less information that is necessary in scene building for things like Maya. And so we had to do elaborate workarounds to actually decay the image and take stuff out, which made the rendering time even longer. So you can imagine that when you have to render several thousand frames, which all have reflection maps and stuff like that, it's just a very unworkable sort of scenario. So seeing as also I'm just terribly interested in working with holographic video, you know, call me old-fashioned, but, you know, it's my dream. I would love to be able to work in real time in the way that I'm used to doing, because drawing in a nice, easygoing way without having to climb the great ziggurat of we are not worthy to learn Maya and all of that kind of stuff. I just like to be able to make a few images rather quickly. So it seemed to me that a really good tool for drawing would be this, the Phantom, which I'd seen many years ago, and seen Wendy Plesniak's brilliant work with modelling forms with this haptic interface. So for those of you who haven't seen one before, this thing, the thing lying down close to the front is the, I think it's called the gimbal or something. Anyhow, it's the thing you hold. It's like a pen. And you can see it's got an articulated arm. And on the screen, you can see a little model of the Phantom itself. That's how you calibrate it when you first start out. And what this cool little machine does is it knows 3D in space where your hand is. So without learning anything, you can actually pick it up. You can make lines with it. Well, you can, thanks to all the brilliant people I'm collaborating with, who I shall just mention now, that I am working with Masataka Tsuka, who's the head of the Scientific Visualization Laboratory at Sydney University, and his student, Shay Goyette, who's written most of the software. And Masataka Tsuka is just a fantastic human interface person who's willing to try anything. And I was also working on this project with the art historian John Gage, who's the world expert on colour in art. But we'll get on to that later. So what I did was really say what we need in terms of software for drawing, for creating content very easily to make digital holograms and mathematically generated holograms as well, because in the first instance, the information is mathematical, so you don't have to go scan the real world and do that because it exists as a mathematical form immediately. As soon as you draw, it's already coded. So it's very easy to export, it's very easy to output, and it's computationally very light. So I thought that it was important to have a kind of a haptic interface, because it's virtually impossible to draw in three-dimensional space without some sort of frame of reference, without being able to lean on something. So I used the laser scans that we'd made for the old project and started using grids inside of them. This all looked like pretty tragic, so I realised that wasn't the way to go, although the template was good. And I just really thought, as I always do, of like, well, who's really the best person in the whole world who knows all about this? And the answer immediately came to me, Michelangelo. And so I was very fortunate to be given access at the Cabinet de Design at the Louvre to Michelangelo's drawings to study. And last year I spent 3 months there going through his collection of drawings and actually making notation to see how he did it, how he created these illusions, which really are, they're kind of the Bible. They're the rules that we understand when we look at the representation, at least of figures. So I'll just tell you a few of the really brilliant ideas that he came up with, and you can see them in this drawing. For instance, have a look at this one. You'll notice that the direction, the lines going in different directions are doing two different tasks. The lines that are going, that are slanting diagonally are describing the shadow, and the lines that are mainly going down the figure are actually describing the contour. Even though the shadowed lines are, they're more regularly spaced. And so it's the separation and recombination of the vertical lines which actually tells you a lot more about the contour, and the diagonal lines tell about the shading. Here's another example of a different idea where a lot of lines are grouped together and they're of different thicknesses. It's a bit hard to make this out, but also there's a lot of kind of scribbly underdrawing before the actual lines of the finished work are applied. And the lines tend to go around the shape, okay? So whenever you get drawing students in a class and they draw something, the first thing they draw is the outline. Well, obviously we can't have an outline because when you move to a different position, the outline's in the wrong place. So there's not going to be any downward marks in our kind of style. And the other very important thing, getting back to transparency, is that Michelangelo, we'll see if I can go back to that. The other thing I wanted to mention about this is Michelangelo doesn't ever draw with the same kind of marks on one side of the body as on the other. Now, you know, a lot of computational time is taken up with hidden line things like not seeing the back of something. I reckon we'll be able to get away with being able to see the back and the front at the same time, making it very light if we can just differentiate, if we can just use this really good idea that he had. And here's another fantastic idea, is that the amount of detail on one side of the figure is far greater than on the other side. So that means that when you rotate a figure around, if one side is fully filled in and you turn it around, you don't actually have a problem, and that in fact you can read right into the volume. So this is stretched out a bit to the side, but we could see that you can't actually just make when you're going to draw for holo video, you're going to draw with white lines, because it's going to be, you're going to draw with light, you're going to have white, you're not going to have black, okay? But I wanted, my sort of perceptual thing is, hey, how come the image on your right looks wrong and the image on your left looks right? So we can't go into making drawing for holo video and just make it a negative. So we're using these laser scans that Stanford Uni did. This is the first little drawing test I did, just of this like sketchy underpinning. Here's David, Michelangelo's David leg with the different kinds of marks. This is with the template, which we can then turn off. This is the leg. And who knows what will be coming up in the future. Well, basically, we can be sure that we have to build somehow on our existing visual language, and we also have to come up with something which is uniquely suited to a system that is using light. But the good news for artists who want to get into making digital imagery, that these little phantom omnis are very cheap, they're easily available, and hopefully in a few years our software will be too, and you'll be able to very quickly make your own content. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Paula. Let's open it up to a few minutes of questions. Too many questions.
Paula, have you done any actual imaging with this? Have you done a hologram yet with this?
No, I haven't. I'm going to be making one to take to China. Okay. And I want to test it out on a few different systems, so I'll probably be making one. I forgot to say that the hologram that you saw of the transparent girl, that was made at Geola. And so I've printed out from, you know, John Perry, from Geola, and from Zebra, and Michael. My next hologram is going to be from Michael Page. So I'm sort of trying out all the different labs that are available to look at all the different effects. I'd love to be rich enough to do the same image across all of them. That would be a really good test. But
right, because that's what
No. But these lines can be saved as .obj files, which means they're very computationally light. They only take like about 2 seconds to render, which is quite different.
Is one of your goals to develop the software so you can go into reflection mapping and, you know, keeping from line, you know, developing more into the other computer graphics higher end techniques?
This is not at all aimed in that direction. It's much more like painting. So, and the whole way of building the image is totally the opposite of that. Thanks for asking me that question, because, like, the mentality behind building something in Maya is like, oh, well, you get a thing, you get a shape, you kind of push it in and out, you make it bigger, extrude it, whatever, and then you get something and stick it on the outside, and then you shine a light on it, and then blah, blah, and then you do the reflection map, and then all these things, the lights, the shape, the everything is all in thing. We don't do it like that. We do it like a painting, but the reason you need a lot more kind of, you need to be able to visualize where the light is, because like a painting, if you want to see a highlight on that cup, you just directly put it there. So although here, this was the early version of the software, it only had white, we've got six colors now. We've got transparency, and The beauty of this program is that the object is not solid. It's totally very different from any other kind of computational object. It's not made out of solid triangles. It's an open form, and so it's specifically designed for holograms. There'll be no reflection maps in this. If you want to do reflection maps, well, you've got Maya. Why make something else with reflection maps? This is a totally different idea about how to construct a computer graphic image. It's more like a painting, but in three-dimensional. So every little mark in the drawing has a position, a value, and a hue, and that's it. And you can make drawings out of thousands of marks, and each one is individually located. That's kind of how, that's my conception of how it should work, and so that's how this is going to work. It's going to be an alternative, basically, which in my mind, as I said, after 6 years of using Maya, like, I thought, please. So that's why.
Paula,
yes.
When you're drawing, what you're drawing with and what you're drawing on can alter the look of the drawing. Are you using any particular tools that let you vary those parameters?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. At first, when I first got the fandom, I didn't know what to do. I got it on a major equipment grant. I'd seen yours, and you had like a kind of more sweet little lovable type fandom. And I decided that I'd get the really big one because I like to draw like really big. So I thought, oh, great, I'll get the big one. And, we got it delivered. We got it out of the box. And we opened up the Michelangelo file of David. And as soon as I touched the hair, the whole machine, like, self-destructed. It ripped its arm out because the force of the curls of his hair. So I thought, yes, right. So we had to sort of... Sensible has developed a force slider, which means I can turn the force right down. And the problem was that the three-dimensional templates often weren't as kind of smooth and as joined. Like, for anybody who's made a 3D print, you realize that all the holes and everything have to be all sealed up and nice, but most computer graphics isn't like that. It's really sloppy. And most laser sands sure as heck aren't like that. You got to fill in all the gaps around all the places where no one thought there were going to be holes. So you sort of find yourself falling through a hole all the time. So I tried using the physical world, my elbow, because it's obvious when I looked at Michelangelo drawings that he mainly used his wrist as a pivot. And what he did was he matched the scale of the limb according to the arc of his arm. So in other words, if he was going to do lines going around a leg, he would draw the leg at such a size that the rotation from his wrist will be the correct curvature for a calf. Very smart kind of scaling. So I haven't really answered your question, but there is a new armrest available where you can actually move your elbow yet still have it located at one plane and move your wrist around, which I don't have yet, but I will be using because it is necessary to move in 3D space the hinge point of the human body when you're drawing in 3D, but I haven't been able to master that yet. But please understand, this is like all brand new, and I'm just kind of getting the hang of it. But it seems to be that having something physical in the three-dimensional space as a bearing is certainly a help. So the template, which you can draw either on the inside of or the outside of, will stay. But, you know, we will develop more things.
Thank you, Paula. Thanks very much.